Hello, everybody. Second talk of Dan Popovici is on the way.
All right, thanks very much. So I'll
Welcome.
go on talking about complex manifolds, but perhaps it's better to it's a good place to introduce a new notion that's related to that. Because yesterday we discussed the notion of complex structure in an abstract setting, and today we're going to take as a vector space the tangent space at a given point to a complex manifold. And first, we need to define an object that's called the tangent bundle, and more generally, the notion of vector bundle. So to make these things more precise, so let's discuss now vector bundles, the notion of vector bundles. And let us start with the notion of topological vector bundle, which is the simplest one, and then we'll make it more general. So let X be a topological vector space to begin with. Topological space. Right, and let us denote by K to be either R or C, right? So we're going to define R vector spaces or R vector bundles and C vector bundles. So let us start with the basic definition. The notion of topological vectors. So a K topological vector bundle, K topological vector bundle on X is the following data. So let's see, it is a topological vector space, a topological space, sorry, a topological space E equipped with a continuous map P going from E to the initially given topological space X, so the map needs to be continuous, such that for every X, lowercase x in capital X, the inverse image of X under P, which is called the fiber, so the fiber of X, which is denoted in this way, E sub X, it is by definition the inverse image under pi of X. So we require every fiber to have a structure as a K vector space, such that for every X, the fiber EX is a K vector space. So either an R vector space or C vector space, depending on the choice of K, and such that. And now the most important condition is what I'm going to write now. It is called the local triviality axiom. So such that it satisfies the local triviality axiom, which requires two things. I'm putting a colon. So it requires that so for every let us write in this way, that there exist an open covering of X, so U alpha for alpha in I, an open covering, so a covering of X by open subsets. An open covering of X such that above each of these open subsets, the vector bundle, the total space of the vector bundle, looks like a cylinder, right? It's O U alpha cross K to the power R for some, so such that E restricted to U alpha So let us write in this way. There exists an a homeomorphism, let's call it theta alpha, from the restriction of E to U alpha to the cylinder U alpha cross K to the R for some positive integer R, which is going to be called the rank of the vector bundle. So, and we require this to be a homeomorphism. So theta alpha to be a homeomorphism. Right. So above every, we have a cylinder above every open subset U alpha, and such that every fiber. So if we restrict this to any fiber for every point x in x, if we take the restriction to ex of theta alpha, we require this to be isomorphic to x cross k to the power r. So it identifies with k to the power r. So we require this to be an isomorphism of vector spaces, right? So once again, this one is a k vector space by a previous requirement, k vector space, the fiber. Every fiber is a k vector space. And k to the power r is, of course, a k vector space too, of dimension R. And we require the restriction of theta alpha to each fiber to be an isomorphism. So this one is required to be an isomorphism of vector spaces. Right? So a vector bundle is what? Is an object, a topological vector space that's fibered over another topological vector space, which is locally trivial. So the fibers are vector spaces, all of the same dimension. And locally on open subsets, the vector bundle looks like a cylinder, right? Like U alpha cross K to the power R. Right, so this is the definition. Now let us give some terminology. Now E is called the total space of the vector bundle. The total space of the vector bundle now X is called the base of the vector bundle, right? The total space, the base. The fibers, the E of X are called the fibers. We've already seen, already said this. And the theta alphas, so once again, they're defined on the restriction to U alpha E with values to E, U alpha cross K to the R. These are called the local trivializations. So this one is a local trivialization. That is a trivialization of a U alpha of the vector bundles, right? So let us draw a picture. So I have something like this. Let's look at two neighboring trivializations. So a new alpha and a neighboring open subset U beta. So if we look at a point, for example, X, which is in the intersection, what is the fiber? The fiber over X. Oh, come on. Is a vector space of I forgot to say R is called the rank. Let me go back to this, and R is called the rank. So the dimension, the common dimension of the fibers is called the rank of the vector bundle. Right. So if we give ourselves, for example, any point x in the intersection of two charts. So we can look at the fiber above x. So this one is ex. And then it gets identified, but in two different ways. So if we use that trivialization theta alpha, it gets identified to k to the power r. And if we use the trivialization theta beta, they both act on the intersection, right? Because theta alpha acts on U alpha and theta beta acts on U beta. So theta beta identifies the same fiber to the same space k to the power r, but in a different way. right? So again, as with the changes of charts for manifolds, there are changes of charts for the vector bundle. So that correspond to changes of point of the point of view, right? And then there is something that's called the transition automorphisms, which explain how the changes of charts operate. Transition automorphisms or transition matrices, automorphisms or matrices. Now, what are these? So they explain how we go from one chart to the other. So if we take, once again, E, let us restrict it now to the intersection U alpha intersect U beta. So as we've seen, this one gets identified via theta alpha with U alpha intersect U beta cross k to the power r to this cylinder, right, over the intersection. And then it gets identified to the same thing, but in a different way via the trivialization theta beta to the same cylinder, U alpha intersect U beta cross k to the power r. But then we can, of course, compose these two things. So here we get theta alpha beta, which is what? We go from below to E restrict to this using theta beta minus one, and then we compose with theta alpha. So this one is theta alpha round theta beta, the inverse of theta beta, right? So this is called the transition automorphism corresponding to this pair of charts. And what do we get at the level of the fibers, right? So at the level of the fibers, what do we get? If we look at for every point x in the intersection u alpha intersect u beta, the fiber ex, so on the one hand, it gets identified via theta alpha to k to the power r. And on the other hand, it gets identified via the inverse of theta beta to the same thing, but in a different way, right? So you can compose these two guys. So this is the composition theta alpha beta that we already discussed. So what does it do? It takes any element, say psi in k to the power r, and maps it to another element that also depends on the point x, right? Because this happens in the fiber above a point x. So let us denote this thing by g alpha beta of x applied to psi, right? So every psi in k to the r is mapped to another element in k to the r, and this generates a map. So we get a map. We get a linear map. G alpha beta of x that goes from k to the r to the power k to the r, which is an isomorphism, right? Because the composition here is an isomorphism. So we get an isomorphism of vector spaces and we get this for every point x in r. So thus, for every point x in u alpha intersect u beta, g alpha beta of x, being an isomorphism, an automorphism of k to the power r, it lives in the space GLR of k, right? Which identifies, this is a space of automorphisms of k to the power r, which is equivalent to, can be identified with the invertible matrices. So it's the same thing as invertible R by R matrices with entries in K, right? So this is what we call the transition automorphism from the chart U alpha theta alpha to the chart U beta theta beta, transition automorphism or transition matrix. So this is called the transition automorphism from the chart U alpha with isomorphism theta alpha to the chart U beta with isomorphism theta beta. And now an obvious fact. So consequence of the construction is that we have theta alpha beta. If we compose it with theta beta gamma, we get exactly theta alpha gamma. So there's a kind of simplification of beta. So why is this? Because remember, theta alpha beta was theta alpha composed with theta beta minus one. And theta beta gamma was theta beta composed with theta gamma minus one, right? And the theta beta minus one, when it gets composed with theta beta, cancels. So we get this one, which is theta alpha composed with theta gamma minus one. And we get this on the intersection of the three things, on U alpha intersect U beta, intersect U gamma. And of course, you get this for any indices alpha, beta, gamma. But then, given the fact that theta, alpha, beta, and G alpha, beta are almost the same thing, right? Except that theta, alpha, beta takes into account the point, and geta, alpha, beta acts at the level of the fibers. So the same thing works for the fibers. So this implies that G alpha, beta of X times G beta, gamma of X equals G alpha gamma of X for every X in the intersection of the three open subsets, U alpha intersect U beta intersect U gamma, and for any choice of triple alpha beta gamma, right? And now what is the operation here? So if you regard these as automorphisms, the operation here is the composition of automorphisms. Composition of automorphisms of a k to the power r. Or if we regard this as matrices, it's the product of matrices. Right? The product of matrices in a GLR of k. Invertible R by R matrices. Now, this relation here, it is very important. It is called the co-cycle condition. So it explains how these things glue together, right? So locally, the vector boundary is trivial, locally trivial. It looks like a cylinder, but of course, when you change the point of view, the cylinder gets moves around, right, in a different point of view. And now you need to know how you go from one trivialization to another, to a neighboring trivialization. So a star is called the co-cycle condition that's satisfied by the transition matrices, the co-cycle condition. The name comes from a certain cohomology called the Dechech cohomology, but I'm not going to describe here. Right, so any vector bond has transition matrices that satisfy the co-cycle condition. But what is interesting is that the transition matrices completely characterize the vector bond. So conversely, we can recover the vector bundle entirely from its transition matrices, right? So let's say construction of the vector bundle from its transition matrices. From its transition matrices or automorphisms, its transition matrices. Let's see how we can do this. And actually, the two notions are equivalent. A vector bound can be entirely characterized by its transition matrix. So let us say data. Let us give ourselves the following data. Let us give, on the one hand, an open covering of X. Open covering of X. And let us give ourselves, for any pair of indices, for any alpha and beta, so the indices vary, say, in a set I, for any pair of indices alpha and beta, let us give ourselves, let G alpha beta be a map defined on U alpha intersect U beta with values in GLR of K. In other words, with values in the invertible R by R matrices with entries in K. And let us assume that this map is continuous, right? I forgot to say that G alpha betas are, of course, continuous. So we're giving ourselves an open covering of the manifold, and for every pair of indices alpha and beta, a continuous map from the intersection U alpha intersect U beta. So this is U alpha, this is U beta. The map is defined on the intersection into the invertible R by R matrices with entries in K. And suppose that they satisfy the curse-like condition. So such that star is satisfied. So the curse-like condition. So once again, star was what we call the curse-like condition, this one here, right? And then the claim is that we can recover the whole vector bundle in a unique way from this data, right? From its transition matrices, in other words. Then, how do we define the vector bundle? Then we set. So we first need to define the total space of the vector U, right? So we're going to take the disjoint union over alpha in I of the cylinders, right? U alpha cross K to the R, right? We have these cylinders locally defined. We take the disjoint union of them, but we need to quotient out by an equivalence relation, right? Where the equivalence relation, we need identification now. The equivalence relation theta is defined by the following thing. So we need to indicate how we identify a triple alpha x psi. So alpha is an index with a triple beta, say y eta. So alpha and beta are indices, I and I. X and Y are points in U alpha intersect U beta, and Xi and eta are elements in K to the power R, right? So by definition, we decree that two triples are identified, so they're equivalent, if and only if the points coincide, so X equals Y, and they live in the intersection of U alpha intersect U beta. And then we decree that Xi is the image under G alpha beta at X, the image under G alpha beta of X of eta, right? Because G alpha beta of X is an isomorphism of K, automorphism of K to the power R. So it takes an eta, which is in K to the power R, to another element in K to the power R that we call Xi. Right? And then we define. And then we set, so this defines the total space of the vector bond E, right? The disjoint union of the cylinders quotiented out by this equivalence relation. And then how to define the projection? We need to define the projection P from E to X, but this is defined in a very simple way. Every triple alpha X Xi is simply mapped to X, right? Remember, the projection takes any point in the fiber EX to the base point X, right? So the triple, the point in the fiber is X, the point in the fiber is Xi, but leaves, So once again, here xi means that lives in e over x, right, in the fiber of x. And the projection just maps the triple to the base point x. And then what is the structure, the top, the k vector space structure of E x is the following. So we take two triples, alpha x xi 1, say, and we want to add them. So alpha has to be the same because we have fixed trivialization. The point has to be the same. The base point has to be the same because we're operating in the given fiber Ex. Only the point in the fiber may be different. So xi 1 and xi 2. And we decree that this one is just obtained by the addition of xi 1 and xi 2. Right, so this one is by definition the triple alpha x and xi 1 plus xi 2. So xi 1 and xi 2 are elements in k to the power r, right? So we take the sum in k to the power r. Now we've got the whole vector bundle, right? We've got the total space E, which is the disjoint union of the cylinders, quotient out by the equivalence relation. We've got the projection map and the k vector space structure of each fiber, and the local triviality axiom is satisfied in an obvious way by definition. Now let us give examples. So for us, the most important example will be the tangent space of a manifold. But before that, let's give some more basic examples. Examples of topological vector spaces, vector bundles. Examples of topological vector bundles. Right, the most basic example is, so people call it the trivial vector bundle, but I like to call it the constant vector bundle. I explain why. The constant vector bundle of a given rank, so of rank R over X. Now the total space E is just X, there's only one global cylinder, right? It's X cross K to the power R, global cylinder over the whole of X. And there's only one trivialization given by the identity. So we cover X by a unique open subset, which is itself. We choose theta, the unique trivialization to be given by the identity, right? The unique, and this trivialization is even global, right? The unique global trivialization. Trivialization. In general, there is no global trivialization. There are only local trivializations. But for the constant vector bundle, there's a global trivialization given by the identity. And of course, the fiber, every fiber is k to the r. Actually, it's even equal to k to the r, but just isomorphic. Ex is k to the r for every point x in x. And the addition is the usual one. If we add two elements, x xi and x eta, this gives x with xi plus theta. And this is just to explain that there is a vector space structure, and lambda times x xi is by definition x lambda xi, right? For every scalar lambda in K, right? So this is the constant vector bundle, which has only one trivialization given by the identity. Now, usually in the literature, you'll see the terminology of trivial vector bundle, but I insist on the fact that trivial vector bundle is not unique in an absolute way. It's unique only up to isomorphism, whereas the constant bundle is unique in the absolute way. So any vector bundle that's isomorphic, the constant vector bundle is trivial. It's called trivial. Now, let me give you another example, perhaps a more fun example. Example two, The Möbius band. So there's, of course, there are several equivalent definitions of the Möbius band, but one fun definition is to see it as a vector bundle. The Möbius band. So it can be seen as a, so the base, let us choose as base space, the one sphere, right? So the circle, the unit circle. The unit circle in C, so the one sphere, right? And now the total space, so actually the vector bundle is going to be a real vector bundle, so K equals R here, rank one. So this one is going to be a real, an R vector bundle over the circle, a real vector bundle of rank one, of rank R equals one. But we need two trivializations. We can't do it in one trivialization. It's not trivial, actually. It's only locally trivial, as any vector bound is, but it's not globally trivial. Now, so let us draw a picture. So the base of the circle, you can see that this is the circle. I did on purpose to draw it differently from a circle as an ellipse. Now we're going to take two trivializations. Local trivialization. We're going to cover the circle by two open subsets. You can't see the yellow. Let's take a green. So let's take two open subsets. That is two open arcs on the circle that meet, right? That intersect. So they intersect over two portions, right? There's a portion here and another one here. So let us take a U1. And U2, subsets of the circle, so open subsets of the circle, in other words, open arcs, that intersect such that the intersection is non-empty. And we take them, each of them larger than half the circle, such that they intersect, and then they intersect into two parts, right? So let's call this part up here U1 to plus. Let's call this second part of the intersection U1 to minus. So the intersection is the union of U1 to plus and U1 to minus. And then we give the following transition mesh. So we take transition functions, take G12 of x. So we need to say that for every x in the intersection, U1 intersect U2, we need to say what the transition corresponding transition matrix is. And as, so G12 of X will be, of course, an automorphism of R. But as you know, the automorphisms of R are constants, right? Are multiplications by constants, by non-zero constants. So actually, G12 of any X in the intersection will be a non-real number. So this one, because R star identifies with GL1 of R. We define it in the following way. There are two parts in the intersection, right? We take it to be constant equal to one if x is in the upper part in U1 to plus, and constant equal minus one if x is in the lower part in U1 to minus, right? So this corresponds to a change of orientation, right? Because if you multiply by one, of course, you don't change anything. But if you multiply by minus one, your vector space, the fibers are now copies of R, right? Because the fibers are R vector space of dimension one. So the fibers are copies of R. And when you move on your sphere, on your circle, as long as you stay in the first open map, on the first arc, U1, your fibers don't change. The copies of R get multiplied by one, so they stay fixed. But when you switch to the other, on the intersection, when you switch to the other trivialization, your fibers get multiplied by minus one. So they change orientation. If you orient R from minus infinity to plus infinity, when it gets multiplied by minus one, it changes orientation. This is one of the definitions, one of the equivalent definitions of the Möbius band. It's not the standard one, but it's one way of seeing this. So of course, S1, the circle, is the union of the two arcs, and the vector bundle obtained in this in this way is called the Möbius band. The total space, actually, the total space of this vector bond is called the Möbius band. Right. And now, let's move on. Now let's put some extra structure. So extra structures. So far we've only defined topological vector bounding, but of course we don't need to stay topological. We can put some extra structure. So let us suppose that X now is not just a topological space, but a manifold, which can be either C infinity or even complex manifold. So let X be a C infinity or complex manifold. And a definition, we say that E is a, say, C infinity or holomorphic, depending on the case, vector bundle a C infinity or holomorphic vector bundle if one of the two equivalent properties holds. One of the two following equivalent properties holds. Actually, these two properties correspond to the two points of view that we've given. So either in terms of a total space with projection or in terms of the transition matrices. So in the first point of view, we require the total space E to be a C infinity respectively complex manifold according to the case. According to whether the vector bound is smooth or holomorphic. We require the projection map P to be more than just continuous, we require it to be C infinity or holomorphic, depending on the case. In the topological case, the projection is only continuous. And then we require the local trivializations, so the theta alphas that are defined on U restricted to U alpha to U alpha cross K to the power R to be C infinity diffeomorphisms. Respectively, by holomorphisms, that is holomorphic diffeomorphism, by holomorphisms for every alpha. And by the way, in the complex case, in the holomorphic case, K has to be C, can't be R. So K is necessarily C in the holomorphic case. Right, and the other equivalent thing, the other point of view, which is equivalent to this one, so this one is equivalent to point of view two, the one using transition matrices, we simply require the transition matrices to be C infinity, respectively holomorphic, depending on the case. So the transition, oh, come on. We require the transition automorphisms G alpha beta to be, so remember G alpha beta, every G alpha beta is defined on the intersection U alpha intersect U beta, which is an open subset of X, which now is a manifold, with values in the invertible matrices of size R by R, GLR, okay? Require their transition automorphisms to be C infinity, respectively holomorphic, depending on the case. Right. So, for example, a holomorphic vector bundle is a topological vector bundle whose transition matrices are holomorphic. Or equivalently, the total space E and the base manifold X are both complex manifolds, and the projection is holomorphic, and the local trivializations are biholomorphisms. Right. And now let me give the fundamental example. Fundamental example of a vector bundle It is called the tangent space, the tangent bundle. Tangent vector bundle, the tangent bundle of a manifold. Of a manifold. X. So let us denote by X the manifold, and the tangent bundle will be denoted by Tx. So Tx that is fibered over the manifold X, let us denote by P the projection, and let us describe this object. It's easier to describe it, it's immediate actually, in terms of transition matrices. So remember that X being a manifold is covered, has an open covering, open covering by charts, by coordinate charts. Right, so remember that the charts are the maps tau alpha for every alpha that goes from U alpha and identifies it with an open subset, let's call it V alpha, in say in Rn or Cn, depending on the case. Let's look at Rn first. Right, so the tau alphas are C infinity diffeomorphisms, as we saw yesterday, C infinity diffeomorphisms that locally trivialize the manifold, right? That make the manifold look locally like open subsets in Rn diffeomorphisms, right? And then we had the maps, the charts yesterday. So tau alpha beta was defined yesterday as tau alpha composed with tau beta minus one. So remember, this one goes from tau beta of the intersection U alpha intersect U beta to the image under tau alpha of the same intersection U alpha intersect U beta. All right, these are open subsets in Rn. And tau alpha beta was the change of chart. That is a C infinity diffeomorphism for every alpha and beta. The tangent bundle, the tangent vector bundle, the tangent bundle of X is defined by the following transition matrices. I'll give both points of view in terms of transition matrices and in terms of projections. Is defined by the transition matrices, by the following transition matrices. Maybe it's not very intuitive to give the transition matrices first, but I give them nonetheless. And then I explain why it's natural to give them in this way. So we define G alpha beta at every point X. So let me write right away, for every X in U alpha intersect U beta, to be essentially the differential map of tau alpha beta, right? So we take the transition map of the manifold, tau alpha beta, which goes from an open subset in Rn to another open subset in Rn, and the corresponding transition matrix of the tangent bundle is essentially given by the differential map of tau alpha beta. But of course, the differential map evaluated a point, and evaluates the point in its original space, which is this one, right? And points here are of the shape tau beta of some x, right? So the differential of tau alpha beta evaluated at tau beta of x, and for any x, right? So for a fixed x, we defined in this way, right? So this one goes from k to, here we've chosen k to be r. So this one goes from Rn to Rn, and it is an automorphism of Rn, so it's bijective. automorphism. Automorphism of Rn. Right. So this completely defines the vector bundle. But let us also give the other point of view. So in other words, the total space of the vector bundle Tx is what? Is the disjoint union of all indices alpha in I of the cylinders, right? So the cylinders are U alpha cross R to the power n, quotiented out by the equivalence relation that we described, right? And then notice that the rank, so thus the rank of the vector bundle, of the tangent bundle, of this vector bundle, the tangent bundle, is the same as dimension of the manifold. That's the rank, because the rank is the dimension of the fibrex. The rank of Tx, the vector bundle, equals the dimension of the manifold X, which we denoted by n. Right. And now let's go back, or perhaps before going back to what we started yesterday, I'd like to give you a few examples of operations on vector bundles. So operations on vector bundles. Actually, they mirror the operations on vector spaces, right? They mirror the operations on vector spaces because vector bundles are what? Are collections of fibers, and the fibers are vector spaces of a given dimension that satisfy the local triviality condition. For example, the direct sum, if we have two vector bundles, E and F, of a same manifold X, the direct sum, E plus F, is another vector bundle over X of rank, the sum of the ranks. So the rank of E plus F is the rank of E plus the rank of F. And the transition matrices are the following. So it's enough to describe transition matrices. So if we denote by G alpha beta the transition matrices of E, I hope the notation is suggestive, and by H alpha beta the transition matrices of F, we'll denote by G alpha beta direct sum with H alpha beta the transition matrices of E plus F. So they're given, they're block diagonal matrices. So in the first block, we take G alpha beta. So this block is of size R by, let us denote by R the rank of E and by, or RE. Let us denote by RF the rank of F. So the first block is of size RE by RE, right? Because these are transition matrices of E. The second block, diagonal block, is the one given by the transition matrices of F, H alpha beta. So this one is of rank RF by RF. And the rest are zero. The other blocks are zero. So it's a block diagonal matrix, right? A block diagonal matrix right. And now let me do of course you can also take the tensor product of two vector bundles, but let me insist on another operation that we're going to use, the dual vector bundle. Now let E be a vector bundle. Be a vector bundle of rank R. So we want to define the dual vector bundle, the dual vector bundle E star over the same manifold X, such that the fibers are the duals in the sense of vector spaces of the fibers of the first one. So such that the fiber of E star over any point X is the dual of the fiber of X for every X in X. Of course, we know how to do this because we know what the dual of a vector space is, but it is not enough to specify the fibers. We have to specify the whole vector bundle structure. So it would be enough to give the transition matrices. So let us explain how they come about. So once again, if we take trivializations, we identify via theta alpha the restriction of E to U alpha intersect U beta with U alpha intersect U beta cross K to the R, and then via theta beta we've done this before, we identify this with U alpha with a cylinder, the same cylinder over the intersection U alpha intersect U beta. But then we want to do something similar in order to describe the vector bundle structure for the dual. So we want to get E star restricted to U alpha intersect U beta that gets identified with the same cylinder actually over U alpha intersect U beta. So it's this cross K to the power R. Via a map that we want to call theta alpha star, right? And the same thing for theta beta. And now the basic thing that we use to do this is the following. So this is elementary. If U is a linear map from A to B, linear map of vector spaces, so I'm looking at the level of fibers of vector spaces, then the dual linear map U star, I'm leaving a space here because I'm going to write it, so it goes from B star to A star. So the dual linear map is well defined, right? Because B star and A star are the, what is an element in B star? It is a linear map from B to K. Let's call this F. And we want to move it to a linear map from A to K, but we have a map from A to B, which is our U. So we simply take the composition F round U, and thus F maps to F round U, takes an element F from B star onto an element F round U, that's in A star. So do you know what happens at the level of matrices with this? So a linear map, if you have a linear map U from A to B, it is described by a matrix once we fix bases in A and B. Do you know what the matrix of the map U star of the dual map going from B star to A star that was described here is? It is the transpose of U at the level of matrices. So this is the transpose of the matrix of U, right? The transpose of the matrix of U. But then we need to take the inverse of this, right? In our case, because if we take just the transpose, we go from the dual of this to the dual of E, but we need to go the other way around, right? So in our case here, we have to take theta alpha, the transpose that gets us, once again, if we look here, if we take the transpose of theta alpha, that gets us from the dual of this guy to the dual of E, but then we want the other way around, from the dual of E to this. So then we take the inverse. We take the inverse of the transpose. And therefore, we get the following transition matrices. We get the transition matrices for E star. They're what? We take the G alpha beta of X, so the transition matrices of the original bond of E, and then we take the inverse of the transpose, right? Take transpose of this, and then the inverse of the transpose. Right, so this is what the dual bond is. It is the bond whose transition matrices are the inverses of the transposes of the original transition matrix. And of course, the rank doesn't change, right? Rank of E star is the same as the rank of E, which is R. Right. Well, we'll come back to this. Well, there are lots of things to say, of course. But let us stop here for the moment on vector bundles. Let us now continue yesterday's discussion. Now let us go back to number two, continuation. Of yesterday's discussion. Right. So let us give ourselves, let's take a complex manifold this time. A real manifold first. So let X be a C infinity manifold of a real dimension. Of even real dimension, right? Let's call it 2n, even. And in yesterday's discussion, we're going to take as a real vector space V the tangent space to X at a given point. So let us fix a point. Let lowercase x in X be a point. And let V be the tangent point, the tangent space at X to capital X. In other words, the fiber over the point lowercase x of the tangent bundle. So this is called the tangent space at lowercase x to capital X. And this by definition is the fiber over lowercase x of the tangent bundle of capital X. So this is the formal definition of the tangent space, the fiber of lowercase x of the tangent bundle Tx. Right? And remember that yesterday we defined the notion of complex structure on a vector space. So suppose they exists, let's call it a J sub X, an endomorphism that is a linear map from Tx to itself that squares to minus the identity such that Jx squared is minus the identity of Txx. Suppose such a thing exists. If it does, it is called a complex structure on Tx. So such a Jx is called a complex structure on Tx. And then let us do yesterday's construction. Then we consider the complexification, the complexified situation. So we complexify, consider the complexified situation. So we put CTX at any point X to be the tensor product of the tangent space of X over R with C, right? And then a J twiddle X is defined on CTX with values in CTX, as we did yesterday. We extend it by C linearity. It's the C linear extension of the original one. So J twiddle X of U plus IV. We define it as Jx of U plus Ijx of V. That's the complexification of the original thing for every U and V in a TXX. And then U plus IV is an arbitrary element in the complexification, CTXX. And then recall that this J twiddle had two eigenvalues, which are plus I and minus I. And then we get, let us take local coordinates now. So let x1, y1 up to xn, yn be local, real coordinates. Local real coordinates on our manifold x centered, so around, about the given point x. And then we put zj to be xj plus iyj for every j from 1 to n. And then we define, remember yesterday we constructed a basis, an R basis in the tangent space, in V, which is now the tangent space. And then we constructed a C basis in V10, and there's another C basis in V01. Now, let us define d by dzj to be half d by dxj minus I d by dyj. So we denoted this yesterday, this was denoted by uj, if you remember. And now let's just define d by dz bar j, the same thing but with plus in the parenthesis. So half of d by dxj plus I d by dyj. And we do this for every j from 1 to n. And then we get t10 at lowercase x of capital X. This is what we called yesterday V, if you remember, V10, right? Today, V is tx, and V10 is, we denote it by t10 now. So this one is the complex vector space that generated by the basis that we called yesterday uj. Now it's become d by dzj. So this one is the C vector space generated by d by dz1 up to d by dzn. So this one is called the holomorphic. Or perhaps let us not call it holomorphic yet. And then a t01, lowercase x of capital X. So this is what we called yesterday V01, is the complex vector space generated by d by dz bar 1 up to d by dz bar n. Right? And then we have the complexified tangent space is a direct sum of these two guys, t10 x direct sum with t01 lowercase x of capital X. But as you remember, yesterday we defined a complex structure on the original V, which now is the real tangent space Tx, by transporting the complex structure of U on zero. And then a complex structure, which is the conjugate of the original one that we called J bar on the same V. So this is also in yesterday's notation, Txx, the real one, direct sum with its conjugate. Right, so we get this. And now a complex structure on the manifold, if it exists, arises in this way. But it also has to satisfy a condition that's called integrability condition. So let us say definition. an almost complex structure, an almost complex structure on the manifold X is a collection of complex structures Jx on each of its tangent spaces. So Jx goes from Txx to Txx. So it's a collection of complex structures on its tangent spaces that vary in a smooth way with a point x in the manifold. The collection of complex structures varying in a C infinity way with a point x in x. And now if the almost complex structure arises, as we described above, from coordinates, we call it a complex structure. Actually, there are several equivalent and rigorous definitions of the complex structure, but since I don't have much time, I prefer to only give you the intuitive thing. So intuitively, it means if an almost complex structure, if an almost complex structure on X arises as above from local coordinates on the manifold, from local real coordinates on the manifold X, it is called a complex structure. So if an almost complex structure arises from local real coordinates on the manifold, it is called a complex structure. Actually, not every even dimensional real manifold admits a complex structure. Right. So, fact. Not every even dimensional a real manifold admits a complex structure. And there are some famous, very difficult problems that are unsolved, asking whether a complex structure exists. But it suffices to say that an almost complex structure is a complex structure if it makes the original differentiable manifold into a complex manifold in the sense of yesterday's definition, right? But what I wanted to say now is that we get, so we get the cotangent bundle, which is defined as the dual of the tangent bundle. We get the cotangent bundle denoted by T star X of any C infinity manifold X as the dual. That's why I insisted 5 minutes ago on the dual of vector bundle, as the dual of any C infinity manifold, as the dual of the tangent bundle of its tangent bundle as the dual of its tangent bundle Tx. And then what is interesting in the complex setting is that the differential forms have degrees. So let's say by degrees. by degrees of differential forms. On a complex manifold. We don't have by degrees on differential forms on a real manifold. So let me explain what this is. Now as you know, the let's take the complexified cotangent bundle. But this one splits. So what's this? These are the maps, homomorphisms, from the tangent bundle, complexified tangent bundle, to C, right? This is the dual of the... this is how we define the dual of a vector space and therefore of a bundle. But then this splits into what we call types. Because it splits, the tangent bundle split into Tx plus T star X. So the cotangent bundle splits into T star X plus T star bar X. And also, into the analogs for the dual now of what we called v10 and v01. So we denote this by lambda 10 of t star x plus lambda 01 of t star x. So let's explain what this is. So where, what is t star x in the complex sense? So it's the bundle, so on a point by point basis, is the space of linear maps that go from tangent bundle to C that are C linear, right? And this one identifies to the dual of t10 of x, the one that we denoted, so this by notation. We denote it by lambda 10. So lambda 10 by definition is the dual of t10, and the dual of t star, so t bar star of x, is the set of maps from tx to c, but they are c antilinear this time, right? So they, if we apply this to lambda times something with lambda scalar, lambda comes out as lambda bar. So these maps are C antilinear. And this one gets identified, as we explained yesterday, to the dual of T01, which is what we call this a V01. And this is what we denote by lambda 01 of T star X. And our terminology the elements of T10 star the elements of let's use this the initial notation, the elements of lambda 10 T star of X are called 10 forms on the manifold. 10 forms on X. So locally, they look as follows. So a basis of this is given by the DZJs. So it's sum over J from 1 to N. A basis is given by the DZJs, where DZJ is defined as DXJ plus I DYJ with coefficients. Uj, and the coefficients are functions. Right, so these are 10 forms locally, in local coordinates. Right, so in other words, the bundle of 10 forms, lambda 10 of t star x, it is generated over C by dz1 dzn. So recall that it's dual, the one that we call t1 zero was generated over c by d by dz1 up to d by dzn. Right? So this is first thing. The elements of t1 zero are called 1 0 forms on x. And now we have something symmetric, which is called zeron form. So the elements of the other half of the space, of the cotangent bundle, the elements of lambda 0, 1, t star 0 of x, which, by the way, is generated over c by dz bar 1 up to dz bar n, where dz bar 1 is, by definition, dx1 minus I di1, dy1, and so on for every index. So dz bar n is dxn minus I dyn. Right, so the elements of lambda 0, 1 are called 0, 1 forms on x. And locally, they look as you would guess. So u equals sum over j from 1 to n. Now the basis is given by the dz bar j's, right? With coefficients uj, which are c infinity functions, locally defined, right? And now we can continue with the by degrees. Now, so moreover, for every k, that goes, so any integer that goes from a zero to the a real dimension of the manifold, that is 2k, we can consider algebraically, right? This space, lambda k, so this is the symmetric, not the symmetric, the alternate product. So lambda k of the complexified tangent bundle, cotangent bundle, c times Tx star, right? So these are the k forms. So this is the bundle, the vector bundle of k forms, k differential forms on x. But now, because we have 1 0 and 0 1 forms, we're going to get degrees p and q. So this one actually splits as direct sum over p plus q equals n of what of what we denote by lambda pq of t star x. And this, by definition, means the following thing. So if we have k forms, it means that there are k dzj's that in the basis. But the, in the, when you switch to complex coordinates, there are now two kinds of complex coordinates: the dzj's that form one that are 1 0 forms, and the dz bar j's that are 0 1 forms. So when you say that it's of type pq, it means that there are p dzj's and q dz bar q. So this guy is actually generated over c by products of, say, dzi1 wedge dzip. So I've taken p dzj's, and then I'm going to take q dz bar k's. Dz bar k1 up to dz bar dz bar kq. Dz bar kq. Right? And as a piece of notation, we denote this by dz I. Let me write on the next page. So where, if we use now multi-indices, so if I is a p multi-index, that is, we take p indices and we order them, i1 less than ip, so they vary from 1 to n because n is the complex dimension. So this one is a p multi-index and let us consider a q multi-index. Let us denoted by k, so one less or equal than k1, which is less than kq, which is at most n. So this one is a q multi-index. Lambda pq, so the bundle of pq forms, is generated over C by dzi's wedge dz bar k's. Where by dzi, we mean what I wrote here, dzi1 wedge dzi p, if the multi-index I is made up of I1, Ip. And by dz bar capital K, I mean dz bar K1, which is dz bar KQ, if the multi-index capital K is made up of indices K1, KQ. So let's give examples, because otherwise you may get confused. We're going to write the forms now in local coordinates, because that's how we compute things. For example, if f is a function, for every f, it has to be at least of class C1, because you want to derive it once. If f is a C1 function, by the way, the functions are called zero forms, as you know, so function of zero form, then df, the differential of f, is a one form, as you know, the one form on the manifold. If we write it in local coordinates, in a real coordinates, in a real coordinates, we get what? Sum of df by dxj dxj over j from 1 to n plus sum over j from 1 to n of df by dyj dyj. Right, and as you know, the vector fields, which are the sections of the vector bundle, have a dual nature, a geometric nature as sections of a vector bundle, which is a geometric object, and an analytical nature as differential operators. So df by dxj, as you know, means the differential, the partial differential of f in the xj direction, the partial derivative of f in the xj direction. But now the same thing, the same object, df, can be written in complex coordinates. So it's still equal. Now, if we use complex coordinates, here too, have two n tuples of coordinates, z1, zn, and they're conjugates. So you get sum over j from 1 to n of df by dzj, dzj, plus sum over j from 1 to n of df by dz bar j, dz bar j, where the partial derivatives are those that we defined before. So let me remind you of the definition. Df by dzj was, by definition, half of what? Of df by dxj minus I df by dyj, right? And df by dz bar j was, by definition, half of df by dxj plus I df by dyj. Right. So this is how we go from a zero form, that is a function f, to a one form, simply by taking its differential. Now let me give you another example. So if we take any PQ form, so let U be a PQ form, a PQ form on the manifold. So this means that it belongs to the bundle of PQ forms, the one that we denote by lambda PQ t star x. Now, locally, it looks like, we've already said this before, it looks like sum over, let's write in this way, over all multi-indices I of length P and all multi-indices J of length Q. So the basis now is given by dzi wedge dz bar J with a coefficient, let's denote, say, but u I j bar, right? So the coefficients are functions. And then we can apply to this the operators del and del bar. So we have del of u by definition. We simply apply del to the coefficients, which are functions. So sum over j and q of I and j, del of u I j bar, which is now a 1-0 form, because del applied to a function. Perhaps I forgot to say for f, but I should have said here, sorry. Let's go back to this. So this sum is called del f, right? The part of the differential of f that uses derivatives with respect to the zj directions. And this part is called d bar f. Right? So we know what del and del bar are on functions. And now on forms, we simply apply them only on the coefficients which are functions, and then wedge with the remaining things that we already had, dz bar I, dz bar j. And we get now a p plus 1 q form. Why? Because the dzi is a p0 form, dz bar j is a 0 q form, and the coefficient has now become a 1-0 form because del has introduced the one thing. So we get a p plus 1-0 form here, and there is another 0 q form. So in total, we get p plus 1 q. And d by u, again, it is defined in a similar way by applying d bar only on the coefficients, which are functions, that is, on the u, I, j bars. So this one is defined to be sum over I of length p and j of length q of d bar of the coefficient I, j bar, wedge dzi, wedge dz bar j. And again, this one now is a 0-1 form because it's d bar applied to a function. 0-1 form, this one is a p0 form, this one is a 0q form. So in total, we get a pq plus 1 form. Right. And now, last observation that I'll be done for today. So observation, which is actually trivial, it follows immediately from the definitions, is that we have del squared equals 0 and d bar squared equals 0. These things follow from the fact that d squared equals 0, as you know, for unreal manifolds, and therefore del and del bar have a similar property, because d, as you know, as we've just seen, is del plus del bar, right? We split d as del plus del bar. Del takes into account derivatives only with respect to the zj's, and d bar derivatives only with respect to the z bar k. Right. And I think this is enough for today. Thank you very much for your attention.
All right. Thank you very much. Any questions? All right. Thanks for this nice introduction to vector bundles.